Joining us now for a live Israel update is Messianic Rabbi Zev Perot.
A wonderful time of year, amazing time of year, a time that I look forward to on the worldly calendar and in the month of December. And towards the end of December, it changes on the biblical calendar, but it's always on the month of December. And the month of December is actually when we close the year, right, on the regular calendar. And then Hanukkah represents like a new beginning. So it's like we're going into the new year after Hanukkah, that beautiful number 8, bringing us into a new beginning where we can continue to shed the light of Yeshua HaMashiach, which really represents the new heavens, new Jerusalem, prophetically. So I love this time of year. And even if you think about, you know, all through the Bible where Yeshua starts his ministry, he goes into the temple, proclaims himself as Yeshua, as a deity. And then, you know, what happens? The religious leaders, they get upset with him. It happened in Nazareth in a synagogue over there. And they take him to Nazareth and they want to throw him off the cliff. And the Bible actually says that he kind of disappeared into the crowd and he went down to Capernaum. But if you look at the Hebrew, there's something really amazing. There's a mystery over there. You can only see it in the Hebrew. It says in the English, you know, that he disappeared, right? But if you look at it in the Hebrew, it's kind of like he beamed away. And I think that represents the beginning of his ministry, and it represents the end of his ministry, but it also represents the new beginnings, new heavens, new earth, that beautiful number 8 Hanukkah that we're in right now. And I spoke to about it with someone yesterday, and he said, wow, we never saw that. And in Hebrew, it's beautiful. Because in English, you just read, he disappeared within the crowd. Well, how did he disappear within the crowd? He just walked off the cliff. No, he just disappeared like a beam of light. Matthew 5:14, you are the light of the world. He gave us the mandate to carry the torch and make it to the end. But you know, this concept of the menorah, the 7 lampstand, there's so much we can mention about it because it's huge. Even Jesus, Yeshua, when he spoke in parables, he even used the lampstand in many parables. One parable is we all know this, you know, nobody takes a lamp and hides it under his bed. You know, what lamp is he speaking about? He's speaking about actually the menorah, the light, Yeshua's light. We look at the book of Revelation, the 7 spirits of the Lord. What are the 7 spirits of the Lord? They're actually Yeshua HaMashiach, once again, showing that perfect lampstand. You think about Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, and I want to read that. That's an amazing contrast to the menorah. Actually, this is what we use here in Israel when we preach the gospel and we show this to Jews that don't believe in Yeshua and they're blown away by it. And it's Isaiah 11:2, and I'll read it. It's the Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. Who's him? It's Yeshua. We know that. The Spirit of wisdom, understanding, the Spirit of counsel, strength, the Spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. Do you know that if you take this menorah right here and you look at the menorah, and you see there's 7 on the menorah. How many spirits over here in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2? The same as the menorah, 7. We have the Spirit of the Lord. We have the Spirit of wisdom. We have the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of the counsel, the Spirit of the knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. The perfect 7 lampstand menorah, exactly like the book of Revelation, the 7 spirits of God. It's the number of perfection, and you know we're using this. I spoke to some Jews just the other day here in Israel, secular Jews even, and I showed them the menorah. I showed them the Bible verse. We read it together in Hebrew, and they all agree this is not a coincidence. The only thing they didn't agree with me about is that the hymn over there is speaking about Yeshua. But you know, time will do. The seed was planted, and if you want to bring them to Yeshua, this is how you do it. Because the hymn, who's the hymn? Then we start going through the Bible verses, we start going back to Leviticus, we start going back to Moses, and the whole gospel can open just by speaking about a menorah, about a lampstand, and sharing this truth. So it's prophetic, it's amazing. We as believers in Yeshua can look at it in many aspects of the Bible, where the Bible says in the book of Revelation also, there'll be no more light, there'll be no more moon, and I'm paraphrasing, but Yeshua himself will be that light. He is the light of the world. He is that perfect 7 lampstand menorah. This is what it's all speaking about. This is why in the book of John, he walks to the temple on the Feast of Dedication. It says it was winter, so we know it's this period of time. We know the time frame is always in winter, December. And he walks into Solomon's colonnade, the Bible says, in the book of John, and he proclaims himself to be the light of the world. And the Pharisees, who knew who he was already, confront him and ask him a question again. And this is after he's been preaching to them and he's been sharing and they saw the miracles. And they ask him again, if you're the Messiah, simply tell us. And Yeshua answers them, I did tell you, but you won't believe. And then the famous Bible passage, John 10:27, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. Where did this happen? This happened in Solomon's colonnade in the Feast of Dedication. That's the concept. But the question has to be asked, why did the religious leaders confront him? And why there? Why ask him, if you're the Messiah, simply tell us? Why not somewhere else in his ministry? Why did they choose to do it over there in the Feast of Dedication? Now, he did miracles. He raised the dead. He healed the blind. They didn't confront him with that question. The next time we see that confrontation, the question is when the high priest asks him, when he's already being judged, and they ask him, are you the Son of God? And he answers them, you say I am. So that was the second time. But right here in the ministry, before that time where he was taken to the cross of the tree, they ask him that same question that the high priest asked him. It's the same thing. And he answers them, I told you, but you won't listen. But I want to touch on why they asked him. Well, because they're celebrating the Feast of Hanukkah, the Feast of Dedication, in Solomon's porch. And if you know anything about Solomon's porch, Solomon's colonnade during the biblical time, it's pointing, the balcony was actually pointing eastward. And eastward's the Har HaZeitim, it's the Mount of Olives. And they know that the book of Ezekiel says that the glory departed from the threshold, from the temple eastward. And the Bible also says in the book of Ezekiel that the glory of the Lord will return to the temple from the east. And for this reason, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, were confronting Yeshua and asking him, if you're the Messiah, simply tell us. And that's the reason. And he's telling them, I'm the glory. I'm the one you're waiting for. It's me, Mashiach. I'm right here. But you just won't listen. You won't see the light of the world, the menorah, the perfect Hanukkah is right there in Solomon's colonnade. And they refuse to accept him because it's not a language issue. Rabbi Eric, it's a spiritual issue. The Spirit of the Holy Spirit can open someone's eyes to the truth. And it's not that they didn't know. They knew in their mind, but they wouldn't accept it in their heart. And this, for this reason, the book of Yirmiyahu, Jeremiah says that God will write the Torah, write his word on the hearts of man. It's a heart issue. Knowledge is not enough.
You know, he entered through that eastern gate on the 10th of Nisan on what the church would call Palm Sunday.
And you mentioned about Yeshua and going in on Nisan 10, Passover, and into the gate. The church calls it Palm Sunday, but why do they call it Palm Sunday? Because it talks about palm branches, right? But if you look at palm branches, very, very interesting, where are palm branches actually mentioned, Rabbi Eric? They're mentioned in alignment with the Feast of Sukkot, with the Feast of Tabernacles. But yet we see here that palm branches were taken in the Feast of Passover. Why? Because he's going to the cross. He's going to fulfill salvation. He's going to fulfill first fruits on Nisan 14, Nisan 15, Nisan 16. And this first fruits ultimately would lead where? To the eternal palm branch tabernacles. So we see once again, and a lot of people don't realize it, that, you know, why palm branches? Palm branches is Sukkot, because it is a foreshadow that if you want to enter into Sukkot, you must go through the tree, through the cross. There is no other way. And that's the reason we see the palm branches also in Nisan 10. What you mentioned, it's beautiful and it's prophetic, but it sheds a lot of light. And Yeshua, he said in Matthew 23, you know, many times he rebuked the Pharisees. And those Pharisees, when they asked him in the book of John, in the Feast of Dedication, if you're the Messiah, simply tell us. And he says, I did tell you, but you just won't listen. He was actually weeping on Yerushalayim. We read in Matthew 23, he's weeping on Jerusalem because he wants them to be saved. He wants them to understand. And he says, you will not see me again. You're not going to have an opportunity again to ask me, are you the Messiah? I've already shown you my glory. I have already preached for 3.5 years or 3 years. I've already raised the dead. I've already did the miracles. I've risen from the dead. You will not see me again until you say, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We find that in Matthew 23, verse 39. It's also quoting it from Psalms 118 because there was no New Testament. Jesus is quoting from then, and he's telling them, you're not going to have that opportunity again because until you call on my name, Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And that ties in with, of course, with Romans 11, 25, the fullness of the nations, and Romans 11, 26, all Israel shall be saved. And it all ties in together. So we can see Passover tabernacles in alignment together with those palms. But also tabernacles also represents the great 8 day, which we know is the going into the new heavens, new earth, new beginnings. We see that concept again. So you can tie every feast together because they're all the same with different prophetic signs. And a lot of people don't know that. I've even asked Jews here in Israel, Lama, why in the Pesach, why in the Nisan 10 are they doing the palm branches? Palm branches are Sukkot. Because you can't enter into the eternal tabernacle if you don't go through the cross. That's the reason. The menorah was actually given to Moses in the book of Exodus. For what reason? To be a light in the temple, in the tampernacle. No menorah, no lampstand in the tabernacle, no light. And then therefore, for the same reason, in the book of Revelation, the eternal temple, the eternal tabernacle with God, Revelation 21:3, we see that Yeshua, he's the light. Why? Because he's the menorah. He's that lampstand that was spoken about. It's a beautiful concept. You can look all through the Bible. And when you understand this concept, you begin to read Bible scriptures in Psalms, in Isaiah, in Zechariah, and you see that concept come to life. And you spoke about the New Testament, the Brit HaChadashah. We're not against the New Testament, but we're saying that it's very, very difficult to witness to a Jewish person who doesn't believe in Jesus and Yeshua using the New Testament. Does that mean it cannot be done? No, I've personally had Jews in Israel over the years who actually asked me, can I see a New Testament? And we're saved by that. So, you know, we can't put God in a box. Not everything is black and white. But in general, we need to acknowledge that all the scriptures in the New Testament, where do they come from? They come from the Old Testament. They have to be there. So we go to the original, the Old Testament, the foreshadow, and this is where we can preach the gospel to them. After they receive the Holy Spirit, after they believe in Yeshua, then we bring them to the New Testament, the Brit HaChadashah, and then the scriptures that they read in the New Testament come to life because they've already got the light from the Old Testament. This is what you spoke about. Paul said, to the Jew I was a Jew, and to the Greek I was a Greek. That doesn't mean that we compromise the Word of God. It means that we're sensitive to the culture when we preach the gospel. If I walk into a mosque here in Haifa or in Jaffa or in Jerusalem, I'm going to take my shoes off. Not because I believe the Bible says to take your shoes off, because if I don't take my shoes off, I can't go into the mosque. And if I can't go into the mosque, I don't have an opportunity to preach the gospel. And this is what Paul was speaking about. To the Jew, I was a Jew, and to the Greek, I was a Greek. Will I go into the mosque and compromise the gospel? Absolutely not. I'm going to preach the truth, but I'm going to respect your culture.